Greetings. Muslims often misapply the Bible because they do not study it for understanding. In this case, I received a grocery list from a poster named Cemukay. He jihads for his Allah, waging Satan's jihad against God's word. In his jihad, he mocks the word of God as contradictory. Let's look at one such claim. Matthew 7:21, not everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Acts 2:21 and Romans 10:13, whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. O Bible, Bible, which part of you is the truth? Presented this way, accepting what the Muslim claims, it can appear to be conflicted. And that is why I formulated rule number one. Never, ever accept what a Muslim claims the Bible says. Look up every verse. Read every passage in context. Matthew 7:21, not everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Acts 2:21 and Romans 10:13, whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. So what does Acts 2:21 actually say and mean? Acts 2:20, the sun will be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and glorious day of the Lord shall come. The first thing to notice is the usage of all capital letters. This is actually directly citing an Old Testament prophet. Joel 2:31, the sun will be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes. Acts 2:21, and it shall be that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Joel 2:32, and it will come about that whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be delivered or saved. For on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem there will be those who escape, as the Lord has said, even among the survivors whom the Lord calls. So there is no question and no dispute that all who call on the name of the Lord will be saved. Keep in mind, this says to call on the name of the Lord. Realize that the name of the Lord is not Lord. What is the name of the Lord? This is the Old Testament prophet Joel, right? So what did the Old Testament prophets know was the name of the Lord? Isaiah 42:8, I am Yahweh, that is my name. I will not give my glory to another or my praise to idols. Psalm 83:18, let them know that you, whose name is Yahweh, that you alone are the Most High over all the earth. Exodus 6:3, I appeared to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob as God Almighty, but by my name Yahweh, I did not make myself fully known to them. Exodus 15:3, the Lord is a warrior, Yahweh is his name. What is the name of the Lord? Yahweh. What name must you call on to be saved? Yahweh. So what does Romans 10:13 say? For there is no difference between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord of all is rich toward all those calling him. Setting the context, this establishes that there is no difference between Jews and Gentiles. For whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. This is also citing the message of Prophet Joel. The New Testament believers based their faith on the message of the prophets. So what about the other verse the Muslim claims is in conflict? Matthew 7:21, not everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Again, always read and know the context. And the context here is even more fascinating than I initially thought. First, let's read the verse all alone the way a Muslim would. Matthew 7:21, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Now, even with no other context, a man of discernment can see where the Muslim errs. What does the person call out? Lord, Lord! But is that the name of the Lord? No. The name of the Lord is Yahweh. Saying, Lord, Lord, is no different than saying, Judge, Judge, or Master, Master, or Dude, Dude. None call upon the name of the God who is Lord of all. And this is reflected in the response of the Lord in 7 verse 23. Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. Why does the Lord command them to leave? I never knew you. And by implication, they never knew him, nor his name. So that is the extent to which a Muslim will bother to read. And they still have a chance to get it right if they thought about what they read. But I mentioned the context was also fascinating. Matthew 7:15, beware of false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. False prophets come with nice, soft, fluffy curls. False prophets come sounding like believers. We believe in your prophets. We believe your Torah and Bible are from our Allah. My Allah is your Allah. But inwardly they are ravenous wolves. By their fruit you will recognize them. Are grapes gathered from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Likewise, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. So then, by their fruit you will recognize them. So that is the context. Good trees and bad trees. Good fruit and bad fruit. False prophets who claim to speak for God. I find it bitterly ironic that those who follow a false prophet cannot understand this verse. Those who follow a man who claimed to speak for Allah, they cannot see his life was bad fruit. They cannot discern he was a bad tree. I have no doubt on Judgment Day, Muhammad will say, Lord, Lord, I was a prophet in your name, Allah. And Yeshua will judge Muhammad and say, I never knew you. But concerning the claim of contradiction, I believe those with eyes to see and a heart for truth can see that Matthew does not contradict the verses from Acts and Romans. Does the person in Matthew 7:21 call on the name of the Lord? No, because they do not know the Lord or his name. This person will be as the seven sons of Sceva. Acts 19:13. Then some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists undertook to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits, saying, I adjure you by the Jesus whom Paul proclaims, or Paul preaches. Attempting to wield authority and position, they had no right to. But the evil spirit answered them, Jesus I know, and Paul I recognize. But who are you? And the man in whom was the evil spirit leaped on them, mastered all of them, there were seven of them, and overpowered them, so that they fled out of the house naked and wounded. And this became known to all the residents of Ephesus, both Jews and Greeks, and fear fell upon them, and the name of the Lord Jesus was extolled. So I think the moral of the story is to know the Lord, and know his name, Yahweh, that you may call on him. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.